spirit. Tell the Lord you don't want to go back the same way that you came. You want to go back empowered. You want to go back strengthened. You want to go back touched. Lift your voice and begin to pray and speak to the Lord. Makapara mandele ba bruz katundala la garinde baria katandala bazipa kuraya leba hala karande lebezuma kata palanda baria kaluru ikamaya palele legarende zibrando zipu shaka paraya. Lift your voice and speak to the Lord. Makaparinde igula lobusheke perende zibranda palagara pashanda la bazipa ragataya paparose ginde legarende labarando labransku takaya. Lift your voice and speak to the Lord. Makapaya leboro shanda lebebe. In the mighty name of Jesus. And let all that believe shout a big amen. All right. Lift up your right hand and say, thank you, Lord, for another opportunity. Say it like you mean it. Say, thank you, Lord, for another opportunity. Hallelujah. All right. We have had a very fruitful week in the past week. On Monday to Friday, we've been fasting and praying in the mid-year revival. All the other branches were around, but I didn't see most of you. I'm only trusting God that you indeed fasted. But if you didn't, it's not too late. This week is another week. You can fast and pray. Amen. Sometimes you want to keep your fasting secret. That is why you don't want to join in the one declared by the church. So declare one for yourself. And fast, because fasting is important. Say amen to that. The seventh month has started, and we are believing God that every vision He laid on our heart is coming to pass. Amen. And there are a few things that I'm going to keep reminding you as the time goes by. But throughout the week, we learned about the simple secret to live an overflowing life. He said that thief comes not but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus has come that we would have life and abound with life. So we learn three simple secrets to live an overflowing life. Brother Sandra just told us that life is easy when you know what to do. So I don't want to leave you with an ambiguous preaching where the preacher will finish preaching and you're wondering exactly what he said and you don't know what you are going to do. Now, the Bible says that it's the doer of the word that is blessed and not the hearer only, which means that every time the word of God comes to you, there is something to be done. Hallelujah. Every time the word of God is preached to you, there is something to be done. Otherwise, then when the Bible says that it's the doer that is blessed, if there is nothing to be done, the Bible will never say that. So every word that comes to you, there is something to be done in that word. And I don't want to leave you confused. I want to tell you exactly what is there to be done if you want to walk in the abundance of God's supply. Amen and amen. So in the 5 days, we learned that there are three simple secrets to living an overflowing life. Number one, you must believe on the Lord Jesus so that you will receive power to live as a child of God after you are saved. That is the first secret. So faith in Christ is your first secret to an overflowing life. Then the second thing we learned is the fact that you must desire and pursue increasing empowerment and wisdom to bear fruit. We said that every man that is born of God has an assignment in life. And for you to be able to discharge that assignment, you need power and you need wisdom. Wisdom will give you the steps. Wisdom will teach you the steps you must take to arrive where God is leading you. And power will give you the drive to get there. So if you really want to be a fruitful child of God, you must desire wisdom and power to really be able to run on the vision God has given you. Today, as my inspirational video, I was watching a CNN video about a Ghanaian doctor who is a specialist in facial reconstruction. And he is a surgeon. And then he's a specialist, cosmetic surgeon. He's a specialist in facial reconstruction. He said when he went to school to study medicine, specialized in the cure of cancer. And the part of cancer he cancers of the brain and of the face. And he realized that very often when people have cancers or tumors in their face, in their nose or mouth, and they come to surgery, usually the most important question they should have asked is, if this cancer is removed, how long will I live? But very often the question they asked was, how will I look after the cancer is removed? So he decided that he was going to also specialize in facial reconstruction, so that after removing the tumors and giving the people hope to live longer, he will be able to reconstruct their face to make them look nice. Are you following what I'm preaching? But that is not the story I want to tell. But he told the story about how after he finished his general practitioner course for 6 years, he needed scholarship to study as a specialist. And then he didn't have anyone to sign the form as a guarantee. So he went to his chemistry teacher and then told him about how he needed a scholarship and needed someone to sign or endorse the form for him. And he said he made a certain promise to the chemistry teacher that if you sign this for me, this is how I'm going to live my life, and this is what I will do after my training. And he said that was in 2005. And up till now, he's actually doing exactly what he promised his teacher. So sometimes as young people, we need help. We need someone to help us. But unfortunately for many of us, when we need the help, we make promises. But after the help is given and we become self-sufficient, we no longer respect the promises we made to those who helped us. It's always very important. I've written a new book, and you can find it in simpevediaco.com/product/pursuits and purpose. And one of the things I wrote there is grabbing opportunities. I said that there are three things that matter: dreams, visions, and opportunities. And I said one of the things about opportunity, when you say, Pastor, there is an opportunity for me to study, there are six questions you must answer before you tell whether it is a temptation or an opportunity. And one of the questions is that, if I take this opportunity, will it allow me to live with people by principle or by favor? There are some opportunities when you take it, you can never live your life by principle anymore. You have to live your life only by favor. Are you following what I'm preaching? So you can go and read the book. It's a very powerful book. I'm going to take my time to teach it. But today I'm not teaching from the book. I'm teaching something that is more foundational to our church and to our doctrine. Are you getting my point? But it's a very powerful book. I wrote it several years ago over a long time. That book was written for over 8 years. It took me 8 years to complete the book. And I told you I've written over 250 chapters. This book is around 178 pages. There are 250 books, but this particular one is about 178 pages, A5. It's quite an elaborate book, and I wrote it over 8 years. And the content have been reviewed, edited, preached, analyzed, and I believe it's a very powerful book that will take you very far. Amen and amen. So today, and then the third step to live an overflowing life, apart from desiring and pursuing increasing empowerment and knowledge. You know, we take our children to school. Why do we take our children? We take our children to school because they need increasing wisdom. If your mother takes you to school to go and learn medicine, your mother just wants to increase your wisdom in helping to cure diseases. If you are taken to school to go and study pharmacy, you are only increasing your wisdom in combining chemicals and herbs in solving man's problem. If you are taken to school to go and learn accounting, you are only increasing in your wisdom to be able to manage money. So life is all about increasing power and increasing wisdom. More power, more wisdom, more profit. Am I preaching to someone? Yeah, so the third step to live an overflowing life, it's not to be selfish, be selfless. Invite others to come and share in the wisdom and the power and the grace which is making you what you have become. So these are three simple steps to live an overflowing life. So this morning, I just want us to go back to the things we've been talking about, and I want us to explore the ancient secrets to power and wisdom. The ancient secrets to power and wisdom. very powerful and very wise. What are the secrets behind the life of Abraham? What are the secrets behind the life of Elijah? What are the secrets behind the life of Jesus? What are the secrets behind the life of Noah? All the great men of faith that you can talk about. We want to explore the ancient secrets of the men of power and wisdom. What are the things that made people powerful? Like when we talk about a man like Daniel. Daniel was a very intelligent and a very powerful man. What are the secrets of his life? So that is what we want to begin exploring this morning. The secrets to ancient power, the ancient secrets to power and wisdom. What is the secret? You don't need to do yoga or Shintoism or Hinduism or Buddhism to discover any ancient secrets. All these religions are not as old. Christianity dates back to creation. The beginning of God and the promise of giving a seat in the Garden of Eden. That was when the Christian faith was prophesied. Am I preaching to you? So what are the ancient secrets to power and wisdom? I want to be powerful because I realize that the more powerful I become, the more profitable and useful I become to society. So what are the secrets? What are the secrets that will guide me to become a very powerful and a very wise person? Acts chapter 2, verse 40 to 47. All the ancient secrets are there because the early church practiced it. And we are also going to practice it. Hallelujah. Maybe go to 39. I'll give you 7 master secrets of all the very powerful head of states, all the very powerful people who ever lived. For the promise is unto, oh, go to 37. Maybe I want to find a certain good beginning so that you go to 37. Now, when they heard this, all right, Peter was preaching and was preaching about Jesus and power and the Holy Spirit and God and all that. And when the Jews heard this, they were pricked in their heart and they said to Peter, they heard a very powerful word and that word really touched their heart. So they went to Peter and the rest of the apostles and said, men and brethren, what shall we do? If these things you are talking about, God, Jesus, Holy Spirit, prophets, things pouring, God himself, everything, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be born every one of you in the name of Jesus. Anyway, you didn't see born, you saw what? Baptized, isn't it? So be repent, go back and let me read what they saw. Then I will explain it to them because what you are seeing is not exactly what it is. Glory to God. And he said, repent and be baptized, every one of you in the name of Jesus. Glory to God for the remission of sins. And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. My God. Verse 39. For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are afar off, as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourself from this unpredictable or untoward generation. Verse 41. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and on the same day 3,000 people were added to them. Glory to God. That is the first secret to power and wisdom. I'll tell you, but let's read on verse 42. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine or teaching and fellowship and prayers and in the breaking of bread, spiritual meal. All the points are there. And the fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. Verse 44. And all that believed were together and had all things in common, and they sold their possession and goods and parted them to all men, and everyone had no need. 46. Let's go. And they continued daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, and did eat their bread with gladness and singleness of heart. Glory to God. Praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church. And the Lord added to the family daily such as have been saved. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Seven ancient secrets to power and wisdom. How many of you can see the secrets? They are secrets, so you can see them there. The first secret to power and wisdom, which is as old as the beginning, is number one, to be born into a family. So the first secret is family. The first secret is family. I said the first secret is family. And if the first secret is family, how many of you know that intelligence is sometimes inherited from parents? Yeah. So the first secret to give birth to wise children is to find a wise man to impregnate you, and you give birth to wise children. Glory to God. As simple as that. Intelligence is very often given by fathers. My father was an illiterate. My mother was an illiterate. Yet I have intelligence. Why? My mother is not an illiterate because she dropped out of school. She's an illiterate because her father in those days said that women don't go to school. So they used to work on the farm so their brothers would go to school. And all of her brothers who went to school became medical doctors. Which means that if they were also taken to school, my mother would have been a doctor. Glory to God. At her age, approaching 90, she can do a lot of arithmetic more than most of you in JHS and SSS carrying calculator. If you like, one day I will invite her for mentor. And any one of you will compete with her. And it will shock you how smart her brain is. So the first secret to power and wisdom is be born into the family of God. Let me give you this example. It's just like you going to the street and finding street children. If, Auntie Fiona, you find a street child and you really want to make that street child as powerful as your own son, you adopt that child. You don't just pick the person from the street, but you go to social welfare and say that this child I picked from the street belongs to this family, but they have come to an agreement. I want to take the child as my own so that that child can now inherit my property, my money, everything. So this family would sign this paper that they have given away their right to this child to me. And from today, even though my blood does not run through this child, by virtue of a certain agreement, by faith and a signing of paper and the authority of the state, this child has become mine. So if I really want to make you powerful, I don't have to make you my friend. I have to make you my child. And God, wanting to make us very powerful, has called us to be his children. Not friends, not strangers. He has called us to be his children. We are born by the will of God and not the will of flesh. God wants me to inherit his wisdom. So he has given birth to me by his spirit. I may not have the blood of God in me, but I have the Spirit of God. I'm born by the Spirit. So the ancient secret to power and wisdom and effective fruitfulness is to be born again. To be born again. To be born again. To them that believe him, even them that believe on his name, to them gave he them power to become the sons of God. He gave them power. Bible says that when we got born again, he gave us a measure of faith. He also gave us his spirit as a guarantee. Ephesians 4:30, do grieve not the Holy Spirit with which you sealed unto the day of redemption. Ephesians 1:13, whom also on whom you have believed, you were given. Go to the Ephesians 1:13. So the first secret of power, if you want your children to be powerful and wise, make them get born again. Lead them to Christ. Taking them to the best schools in the world would not make them powerful and wise. I'm telling you, when they are born again, that
So that's where wisdom begins from. That's where power really begins from. To them that believe on his name, he gave them power. So real powerful people are born of a certain spirit. Even the fetish priest, they were ordinary young men and women walking around until a spirit gave birth to them. Am I preaching to you? Yeah. In whom ye also trusted after ye believed, after ye had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after ye trusted or believed, were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. So in the supreme courts of heaven, a seal was placed on your confession. Supernatural, you said, I believe in Jesus to be my Lord and personal Savior. And God placed a seal. And that seal is the Holy Spirit. Placed that seal on you and said, from today, you are my own. Am I preaching to you? So he said, I said, a man be born of water and of the Spirit. That man cannot live in the house of God. The heavens are for the Lord and the earth is the habitation of men. So except a man is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. The first secret to power and glory and wisdom is to be born of God. It's an ancient secret. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Let me give you the second ancient secret, which you can find in Acts chapter 2, verse 37 to 47. The second ancient secret is the secret of tutoring. Is the secret of tutoring, is the secret of teaching, is the secret of teaching. Galatians chapter 4, a child, though is the heir of all things, different not from a servant, except he be put under tutors who raises him to maturity. Am I preaching to you? So except, I mean, okay, now, how many of you know that Prince Harry in England didn't do anything to become a prince? He just had to be born by a princess. Is that correct? Or by another prince, and then he just became part of the royal family, isn't it? All right. Now, when you are made part of the royal family, how many of you know that you never really grow to become a royal except you are tutored and mentored into royalty? How many of you know that? Yeah, when you are born, and everywhere, I mean, everywhere in Ghana, even our small chieftaincies, if you are going to really become the next chief, like the president of Santihini, if he goes to be, I don't know whether he will go to be with the Lord or go to be with his ancestors, but if he goes somewhere, another chief would have to come. Whoever would have to come is being mentored somewhere, because he himself was sent to go and be with one uncle at Sehiu also to be mentored in royalty. In royalty. So listen, if you say you are born again, so I should leave you to do what you want, you are being stupid. Because being born a royal does not make you walk in royalty. You are mentored and tutored and guided into royalty. It's an ancient secret. So parents who don't mentor their children are destroying great potential. So you've given birth to your child. Your child has the potential to become anything in life. And if you leave that child alone, that child will go to prison. Am I preaching God's word to you? So an ancient secret to wisdom and power is tutoring. That is why you don't have to stay home. That is why Tuesday and Wednesday evening meetings are for you. Wednesday evening meetings are for you. Friday evening meetings are for you. Because you must be mentored and tutored. Somebody must raise you into becoming what God wants you to be. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Sometimes you don't get the point. My son became 13, I think on Wednesday, and I started reading my second book on parenting a teen. I must be mentored. Listen, my son is growing. I'm supposed to be a father. Father is not just donating sperms and having a child. Father requires training. Are you getting the point? So I'm training myself as a father to be able to raise a teenage son. Want him to inherit things that I am struggling with because perhaps my father didn't teach me. Am I preaching God's word? So I've started even educating myself on how to raise a teen. I'm reading my second book. For me, maybe I'm not too intelligent, but listen, I take everything I do very seriously. So even fathering is a serious business for me. It's a serious business. I don't want my child to grow and I have no relationship with him. I mean, lots of you don't have any relationship with your father. I don't know what relationships, but do you know that one thing that will really tell me that you have a great relationship with your father is if you can get home and sit on your father's laps. You should be able to run to daddy. You should be able to talk to him. Listen, all of us, as we're growing up, one of the beautiful moments we remember are the times we spent with father, papa. A personal thing, not when he dealt with us as groups, but when he dealt with us personally. Amen. So tutoring. Your father may not be able to tutor you, but he must give you to tutors. Your father must bath you and take you to school. So it's not enough to just belong to a family to become powerful and wise. You must be tutored. Your potential must be developed. Your grace must be developed to enhance. Am I preaching to you? I have worked with a lot of people who come out of school, and they come out of school knowing nothing. Their heads are empty. We have to put something in their heads. Because whatever you are learning in school is not applicable in the world. I mean, when your lecturer was teaching you on taxation, did he ever teach you that on taxation you just have to get someone who works in the Internal Revenue Office so that there is a special thing that is being done? I don't know what the calculations are. So that when they are coming for prosecution, you go and look for your file and remove it so you're not be taken. Were you taught that? Yeah. So whatever they taught you works in heaven. It doesn't work in Ghana. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Oh, you are not hearing what I'm preaching. So when you come, we teach you that these people you are going to take taxes from, they are the one who feed us. They are the one who bought this cash for us. So when you go there, you have to be humane. And I mean, one of the courses I loved when I was training as an engineer was Engineer in Society. I loved that course. Engineer in Society, they were telling us about a story about a village that used to use something they used to defecate in the open, and they went to construct KVIP for them, and the people didn't use it. And for years, so one day, they sent some people to go there and appraise the project. And when they went, they realized that the KVIP was clean, the holes were clean, nothing was inside, they were not using it. So they asked the people, why are you not using it? And the people said, in our village, the shit of a woman should not touch the shit of a man. Otherwise, the gods will be angry. So once you have dug a single hole where all the shit will go, we cannot use it. So if the engineers were really, they had the human face, they would have known that these people would never use the KVIP except to dig a separate hole for women and a separate hole for men. That's what we call engineering society. So somebody must tutor and mentor you to become really powerful and really intelligent. Am I preaching to you? Let me give you the third secret to ancient wisdom. It's fellowship. Fellowship. How many of you know that, how many of you know you can be part of a family you don't fellowship with? Eh? Fellowship is the fellowing and the shipping and the rubbing together and coming together and trying to smile together and talk together. But I can belong to a family and I don't smile with anyone in that family. And that will not really make you intelligent. So, father, don't just take your children to school. Be there to rub your hands up on their back and on their heads and impact spirituality. So, fellowship is an important secret. Am I preaching to you? Yeah, God bless you. We'll see you later at 12. Glory to God. Amen. So, fellowshipping is important. Am I preaching to you? So, you must. It's an ancient secret. An ancient secret. There's something you don't understand. There's an ancient secret. An ancient secret. As a teacher, there is one thing I have found out. Most of the children I taught whom I had fellowship with always do better than what they could naturally have done. Always, when I teach children and I fellowship with them and I try to bring them close, I give them the opportunity, I make them smile, I hear all the foolish things they want to say and smile with them, they end up doing better. So fellowshipping is an ancient secret to power and wisdom. Hallelujah. All right. Acts chapter 2, verse 37 to 40. Let me give you the next one. How many secrets have you written so far? 4. You must be born into a family. You must be what? Tutored, isn't it? And then you must have what? Fellowship. You have written 3. All right. The fourth one is prayer. Every child who doesn't know how to ask for what he needs and to ask for pardon, that child will not grow powerful or wise. You must learn asking. Are you getting the point? It's not like you are in the house and just because you are a child, you went there and there was bread on the table, and then when they just took a knife, you cut half and put jam in it, then you are eating. Usually, that is not how it is. Every child must be taught how to ask. One day, somebody told me, I will ask if you now, you think I need it, you give it to me, I'll take it. I realized that the person is not growing wiser. Children are supposed to ask. One day, someone was going to school, and I said, your school fees, before I said, oh, he has not given. I said, have you asked him? He said, but when I came, I gave him the bill. Doesn't he know that school is about to reopen? I realized that this child has been trained as a fool. Children must be taught to ask. So the ability to ask, the ability to pray, the ability to ask, the ability to ask. The prodigal son was young and foolish. He came back and said, I will go back and ask my father to make me a slave. Asking. Am I preaching God's word? So prayer makes us wise. Jeremiah chapter 33 verse 3. If you'll ask, I will show you. If you don't ask, I will shut you out. Am I praying God's word? Great secret of power. Luke chapter 18 verse 1. Men ought to pray always and not to grow weak. So prayer is a secret to grow strong. Sometimes they will tell you, was Steve Jobs praying in tongues? Steve Jobs was not praying in tongues, but he set up Apple. That is, you see, they are myopic in their thinking. Steve Jobs didn't pray in tongues, but Steve Jobs practiced yoga. And both of them, praying in tongues opens up my spirit for a particular spirit to empower that spirit. Doing yoga also opens my spirit for a particular spirit to empower that spirit. The spirit that empowers my spirit when I do yoga lives in hell. So when I die, I will join that spirit in hell. The spirit that empowers my spirit when I pray in tongues lives in heaven. So when I die, I join that spirit in heaven. It's your choice. Did I repeat what I said? Steve Jobs does yoga. And when he does yoga, his spirit opens up for a spirit to possess him. That spirit lives in hell and in the midst of fire is the spirit of the devil. When I pray in tongues, my spirit also opens up and another spirit possesses me and empowers me. That spirit is the spirit of God and lives in heaven. When I die, if I was possessed by a spirit from hell, I'll go to hell. If I was possessed by a spirit from heaven, I'll go to heaven. It's your choice. God will respect your choice anyway. Am I preaching God's word? So don't say that Steve Jobs said he doesn't pray in tongues. Steve Jobs doesn't pray in tongues. What do you mean by he doesn't pray in tongues? Do you know why he prays him? No, you don't understand. We talk about something like family or fellowship. Fellowship, another word for fellowship is fraternity. All these people, your former president, sitting president, and past president, are they not members of the Freemason or whatever? Why do they join it if it's nothing? Why do they love that fraternity? Because being part of that fraternity has a way of empowering you and has a way of making you wiser. That's why after all their busy schedule, they'll find time at midnight and go and put on black suits and white shirts and aprons and with swords and other things, chant to demons. And when they come, they say it's just a social club. What makes it social? It's an ancient secret. Don't let the devil deceive you. So when we come together like this and we are fellowshipping, Bible says that iron sharpens iron. As I've come, what I'm speaking to you is sharpening you. Some things are falling off you. Other things have been impacted into you. Take this fraternity serious. Take this fellowship serious. Amen. Prayer. So as we pray, our spirits are synchronized with the spirit of God. If you have walked with me, one of the greatest secrets of my life is quiet time. That's how I get to know what we must do and at what time. I sit quietly before the Lord. Sometimes I begin by praying in tongues. My pen and paper is on my side. And as I pray in tongues, the Lord will tell me, just write something. There have been times I'm just praying in tongues. having my quiet time, and the Lord will tell me, pick your phone, I pick my phone, call this person.
You need to get it.
How did Pastor know that he has to go to Sierra Leone? Because in his quiet time, the Lord spoke to him. I was quiet, and heaven began to speak to me. Glory to God. Am I preaching God's word to someone? Am I preaching God's word to someone? So prayer, quiet time, is very important. I can't miss it at all. As I stay in prayer, I can't miss it at all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm preaching about ancient secrets for modern people. Amen. How many of you know the next secret? How many have you written so far? Four. The next secret to power and wisdom is spiritual meal. I said a spiritual word, meal. Spiritual meal. Are you getting the point? Some of the spiritual meals that are cooked, and most of you who come from idol background, is blood food, where they slaughter an animal, pour the blood into an earthenware, cut tomatoes and garden eggs and other things into it, put it on fire to cook, and cut into pieces of cake and fed to family members. It's a spiritual meal. Some of you, when you are coming from your hometown, your father, the Togbe, prepared something using a snake head as potion. And said, open your mouth. You open your mouth, they put it on your tongue. It's a spiritual meal. Am I preaching to you? It's a spiritual meal. It's fed to you to make you powerful. It's fed to you to make you wise. One day, I went for a naming ceremony and I saw something. The child was named after a certain man. And after they were named him after him, he took schnapp, put it in his mouth, opened the mouth of the child and spat it in the child's mouth. It's a spiritual thing. It's a spiritual thing. He has impacted something. When we went to the funeral, there was a young boy who was walking around, and there was one of these guys who calls himself an executioner. He poured drink into a glass and drank it and left a little, and the young boy was passing and called him and said, take it and drink. And the other guy said, man, no more benya beye. Sometimes you don't know why the churches like Methodist and Presby and others and Catholic are so powerful. And for ages, they are there. You cannot collapse it. I don't know whether it has changed. But when we used to go to the Catholic Church, the wine is poured in one big silver cup. And you come. Everybody drinks, so you come there, you drink from the same cup, and the priest is feeding everyone. Your saliva will enter, then I sip your saliva, mine will enter. And they poured it and poured. It's a spiritual meal. It's a spiritual thing that bound the souls and the spirits of the people together to the creed. We come into charismatism and we are so special that everybody wants his own cup, and the cups are given and it's disposable, and I don't want somebody's saliva. That is why even when we say go around and shake hands with someone, you don't want to shake anyone. Spiritual meal. At 6 o'clock, I'm serving communion. John chapter 6 says that he that eats of the bread and drink the wine has eternal life in him. It is not an ordinary bread or wine. It's a spiritual meal. That is how we receive eternal life into us. It's an ancient wisdom that gives power and wisdom. It's a secret. Am I preaching God's word? I don't know what you'll be doing at 6 o'clock, but that thing is not as important as the communion I'm serving. It's not. I've put it on record. It is not. When you eat, you receive eternal life. It's the secret to health. It's the secret to peace of mind. It's the secret to strength. Spiritually. One day somebody did something, I was shocked. I'm serving communion, and the person was walking out. I was shocked. I'm serving communion, you are walking out. I realize you lack understanding. Spiritual meal is part of it. How many have you written so far? Five.
Okay, let me give you the second, the seventh one. The fear of the Father. The fear of the Father. An ancient secret to power and wisdom is the fear of the Father. Anybody who say, oh, I don't fear my Father, that person is not wise. The fear of the Father. I don't say run away when your Father is coming, but respect his words. Amen. And fear of who? Fear of the apostle. Fear of who? Fear of Jesus. Fear of you, the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Father is a secret to power. I read the story of the Rechabites to you, how they were taken to an inner chamber in the temple and offered wine, and they said, our fathers told us not to plant vine, let alone drink of it. Are you getting the point? Not to plant vine, let alone drink of its grapes. That's all. So we are not going to drink. The fear of their Father made them powerful. The fear of their Father made them powerful. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. And the final ancient secret of power and wisdom which I'm going to share with you are sacrifices. 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 It's an ancient secret. Sacrifices. Sacrifices. The sacrifice of praise, which is the fruit of the lips, and the sacrifice of your substance by which you honor the Lord, then your barns are filled. Seven ancient secrets to power and wisdom. Seven. Be born into the family. So the first secret is being born, the kind of family you are born into. The kind of family. That is why there was a prophet who was having a meeting. And the whole meeting was about, they were praying about family foundations. And all the prophet was trying to do was to prophetically tell people that this is the family you were born into. And by what you were born into, these are the things that work well in your destiny. If you are born into a family of business people and you say you want to be a policeman, you can never be a correct policeman because you turn the policing into business. You just tell the people, when you catch a criminal, you say, this thing, if I take you to court, they will fine you 1,000 Ghana cedis. So you can give me 700. If you go to court, to the transportation you bring up and down. If you come four times and every day you spend 100, add it to 1,000, it's 1,400. If you give me 700, it will save you a great deal. So that we don't even wait the time of the judge. It's not like you are corrupt, too. You are only making business sense. Am I preaching to you? Yeah. So if you are born into a family of business people, don't go and be a policeman. Just do business. Sell charcoal and chalk. That is better. Otherwise, you turn it into a business. Am I preaching to you? So be born into a family. Glory to God. That's why I will not dream about becoming a policeman. What am I going to do in police uniform? Ah, I can't be a policeman. Because I always do calculation to you. I say, oh, Charlie, this thing you have done. If I take you to court right now, 50 years in jail. And if you are going to earn 40,000 every year times 50, multiply. So just give me 20,000 and let us write up this case. Nobody will hear about it. I mean, and I'm not corrupt. I'm only a businessman. I make sense. After all, when you go to jail, what profit will the nation get? The nation won't get anything. So you just give me 20,000 and go home. That is okay and better. So I would have turned policing into a big business. If you make me the IGP, nobody will go to jail. I'm telling you, if you make me the Minister of Interior, all the jails will be empty. I don't see any sense. Listen, I'll tell you this. I don't see any sense in taking someone who has raped a child to prison to go and spend 10 years and be fed by me, my tax money. When we have baller around, the streets are weedy. No. You are just caught. You are going to work. That's all. So the prisons will be empty, will only be sleeping places. The gutters are choked. What are they doing in the prisons? Bring them out to clear the gutters. It is more economically profitable. What are they doing in the prisons? Being fed by free men working legitimately, their taxes. If you make me Minister of Interior, prisons will be empty because I'm a businessman. I won't do anything that does not make business sense. Are you getting the point? Glory to God. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. I said hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, me, if you make me the Minister of Interior, if you go and smoke weed and they catch you, you won't go to jail. You, if you have energy to smoke weed, you plant cassava. Just take you to safety. Go and plant cassava instead of planting wheat. Go and plant cassava. Go and plant corn. Don't plant wheat. And then that's all. I mean, everybody will make economic profit and will be free labor. We won't pay them. They will just work for 15 years. Are you getting the point? Then we get a lot of money. Glory to God. Ancient wisdom to power. I finish. I have more to say, but check your time. I need to close. Be on your feet and begin to lift up your voice and speak to the Lord. You have heard something, isn't it? Some of you are not born again. Speak to the Lord and say that, Father, can you really adopt me into your family? Can you really make me your child? Can you accept somebody like me to be your child? Some of you, you cannot submit to tutoring. Can you pray and say that, God, would you help me to submit to tutors? Would you help me to submit to wisdom? Would you help me? Would you help me? Some of you, you don't know how to ask. You don't know how to pray. You say that, God, can you teach me to pray? Teach me to pray. Lift up your voice, whatever you heard, and begin to pray about it right now in the name of Jesus. I can't hear your voice. Mark.